I've been talking to Pandit Narendra Sharma about his years in Almora and the inspiration for his works, including the link between word and movement. Now, you have another very well-known work, Kamayani, which is based on Jaishankar Prasad's poem of the same name. Now, the poem is massive. How did you do the treatment of word dance, thought dance in the case of Kamayani?
Again, I only picked up words,
keywords,
you know, that's the thing. What really in Kamayani was touched to me, that man has two instincts, the heart and the brain, intellect and intuition. Mm-hmm. And I felt ki sometimes man works by only intelligence, you know,
yes,
intellect, you know, and we are in this world, you know. Intuition, the heart is neglected, you know. And sometimes there is an extreme of the life where that man says, look here, it is my fate to live this
life. Where the
brain doesn't work because the faith has that. So I think what it has made, the final crisis today, is a very modern work, you know. And of course, literally very high. You know. Conflict today is between intellect and intuition. You see, we cannot, I worked out further, you know, by intellect, science and this, and we have gone to destruction war. By heart, I think we have accepted the fate and die, this is my destiny, you know, because by intellectually we don't want to fight. In that I feel the man is trying to combine them both and find out another alternative. Mm-hmm. I think Kamayani is just this, you know.
Right.
Man, intellect, intuition, brain and heart has to combine together, and this is the third dimension. Technology, science and with aesthetics, heart has to combine this.
When you do your training, now the training of the body is one thing, opening up the mind is another thing, but do you as a teacher of dance insist on your students reading?
Well, we try in our troupe. We try, we invite people, we sometimes talk, and we ask them. But you know, again I tell you, this troupe or any troupe, it is within a structure that you have to do a production and present it. That, you know, the training part, I did this when I was Almora because I had not to do a production. So, you see, I have to learn a theory and write about theory. Here we are tied down with the productions, and that is a tense sort of a thing.
The pressure of production.
Oh yes, the entire the creative dance is production oriented, supported by Department of Culture. There is not a single school where the choreographer tries freely read about it. What we do within that structure, we try to encourage people and all these things.
If there was no support from the Department of Culture, then maybe contemporary dance would find it hard to continue to exist. But the support, unfortunately, is production driven, so we have no option in
that. You are correct, and due to this production oriented, it is working also. But you know, when there is a production of the classical dance, you see they get trained dancers from somewhere. When the production of Kathakali or anybody, there are schools, they can get trained dancers. Where am I to get trained dancers, you know? I have got to double work, train my dancers and the production also.
Right.
And moreover, I train the dancer production oriented, not as a choreography is, whatever it is, you see, is taking sort of inspiration.
You don't get that kind of time with your dancers.
Yes, I don't get time.
But I must say, you have quite a rich body of work despite that, Narendraji. Huh. Now, I'd like to bring you to a very unusual feature, which I find is a strength with contemporary dance, and I'd like to just share this with you. I believe that classical dance forms, because of their themes and their legends and the myths and the structure, cannot deal with some of the very interesting rasas, the hasya ras, for instance, you know, humor. It's so much a part of our life, and yet when you go to see a performance, you feel that Indians have no humor, no sense of humor. But that doesn't seem to hold good in the case of modern dance.
I think we lack humor as a people. And I think Indian dance doesn't have humor. Mm-hmm. And I feel very pained when once you are able to laugh, you know, it's relaxing you then. And when I did conference, I did it in 1979.
Now, conference is one of your important works where humor is the keystone.
When I did in 1979, I was being in a school, I was looking for 1979, year of the child, something will be done, UNO and all these things. And there were conferences, there was a, just unfortunately nothing happened, you know, in spite of lectures, you know. So it was a, almost a reaction, ki how child is being neglected. But the form I took is the humor.
Humor.
And I was very inspired by R.K. Lakshman's cartoons. I think I see every, I really love his cartoons, you know. Because, you know, I think there, even I bring it as sort of a placards also, questions also, listen. And finally, I think it ends up when the files and everything is taken by the rag picker to be sold, heavy sort of a thing. The picture of the child is being taken also, and when it is put in the sack, you know, there's a pitiful cry from the child.
Yes.
But that picture is going to be sold in the rags, you know, sir. That's what it is.
The Bhumika Creative Dance Center was formed in 1972 at the initiative of its founder director, Narendra Sharma, and the patronage of his guru, the late Uday Shankar. Ever since its existence, Bhumika has created a niche for itself as a body dedicated to free expressions in dance. Its founder director, Narendra Sharma, has had a long and illustrious career as choreographer, spread over 5 decades. In this period, his constant search for new content and form in his dance has made him one of India's leading innovative and creative dancers in the contemporary scene. Narendra Sharma is a recipient of the Sahitya Kala Parishad Samman, the Sangeet Natak Academy Award, the Fellowship from the Government of India, and the Soviet Lal Nehru Award. In this production that is presented by the Bhumika Creative Dance Center, they take a look in a humorous and satirical manner at a conference dedicated to the girl child. Its inspiration has come from the work of India's cartoonists who hold up a mirror to the reality that makes us laugh at ourselves even as we accept the situation for what it is. You must have noticed that in conferences there is a lot of empty ritual and ceremony associated. For instance, there are inaugural ceremonies, feasting, hospitality, of course arguments and counter-arguments too. But once all the noise has died down, one wonders how much one has actually achieved. For the secret agenda of every conference is self-aggrandizement. This production has been conceived, directed and choreographed by Narendra Sharma.
Thank you. Thank you.
Narendraji, the medium you have used in conference is humor, but your message is still very serious. And a constant thread that runs through your work is a serious message always. If you take the case of Antarchaya, in which you have talked about spaces, especially silent spaces, I presume that an artist needs to work in. How is it that such an abstract idea you are able to translate into dance, and where does the theme come from? How do you develop on it? Use the case of Antarchaya, for instance.
It starts with the man extending his territory, mental territory, you know. And the man flags me, he stretches out a very big sort of a thing, and a square, and he holds the door. This I got from the tale of Tolstoy, okay. How much land the man needs.
Man needs, yeah.
I say. You see, he's there. And ultimately, the earth is trapped. And that's what I thought. And she's trapped so much that she's dragged this way, that way, you know, those flagholds.
For you to have an equation and a reaction from the audience, you must be present there, right? The artist must be present there,
yes.
So you have a reaction from the audience. Yet in Mukhantar, you used a very bold technique where you neutralized the dancer. You wrapped the dancer's face in layers of cloth so that the dancer was at best a body. Mm. And sometimes when light fell on the face, you could see contours, but you never saw an identity. Mm. There was no contact with the eyes. There was no sort of, you know, enough skin space, for instance, to get the energy vibrations and all that. Why did you do that?
You see, because again trying some new form, one day I tied the some cloth on this, and just lines, broad lines were there. And you know, you do a lot of movements with the hand, and I said, why lot of movement, cover them completely. So the dancers were covered completely with long cloth, and just outline, and I started improvising. It gave me another picture, I tell you. And I said, now the production will be where I will negate all the facial expressions and all the intricacies of the dance, but
the dance will exist, not the dance.
Dance is there, but you know, dance was seen through the facial expression was seen through the covered faces, and the actions were seen behind it. And some critic write, there were actions in spite of covering all the thing. So I end like that, give hugeness also.
Thank you.
every situation gives its own challenges. I mean, that hugeness, I remember in Martha Graham's Lament, mm-hmm. so beautifully it was used. And incidentally, I must tell you this, that in the classical tradition, Kumudini Lakhia once told me that for me, choreography is that where the dancer is neutralized, the dance is decontextualized, mm-hmm. and all that you see is the spirit of that piece. The space, the dancer can change, but that piece will remain for what it is.
That way, I think I always feel when you start choreographing a thing, you should not have a technique in mind. You should not have this. Start almost by zero, and then pick up points, you know, from there. And once you go one step forward, you know the technique by itself. I, of course, it's practice, I tell you. It's practice.
From amongst your latest works, would you like to tell us a little bit about the... You've done a work around a tree.
Tree. I think when they are talking environment all around, I think we are treating the tree as our necessity for, you know, this sort of a environmental necessity, because there is environmental degradation. And so man is becoming selfish to see the tree for his benefit or this. I see in Indian mind, nature is very close to us. I think even the idea came from the Buddha, you know, when he got enlightenment under a tree. I think is the nature we have to sort of examine. So I have treated tree as a symbol of faith. Sun and earth, prithvi or sur, this is the theme I got from the nature. Actually, I have a larger production which is called Kalpvriksh, means the eternal tree, the cosmic tree. And this is the part where the sun and earth merge into each other, the energy of the sun and earth coming from below, they merge into it, and beautiful nature abundance comes through it. Now sun, I have a rod where three lines are there and the sun is there. Earth is symbolized by a big leaf, and she rolls to the sun, merges into it, and becomes a one integrated to create new a natural life. So this is the part of this production. Of course, finally it symbolizes the eternality of the tree, cosmic tree. Thank you.
Narendra ji, what is the training that you constantly seek?
Well, in my own way, you see, I provide different mediums. For example, I have martial arts. We had music classes. We had painting classes. We had yoga classes. Sometimes, you know, we arrange workshop with the there were recently the Israel choreographer who did the workshop. There are sometimes foreign choreographers do the workshop. We have a very planned way sort of it. And moreover, Paul Taylor company came here, worked with us. Israel company came, worked with us. You see, that way, I think dancers get enriched with this sort of
thing. Right. So it's many influences that go into make a dancer.
And that makes the flavor. Then I can easily adapt them to different sort of things. And moreover, I have my own system of training, which exploration of body and, you know, that sort of thing is there. So,